last years of Queen Victoria's reign, there seemed no limit to what could be achieved by British military and economic might. As rival European empires scrambled to divide up the uncolonised world, a new breed of British imperialists could confidently insist on taking the lion's share. Yet in the space of a few years, as the 19th century gave way to the 20th, arrogance turned to anxiety. And even before the Queen Empress expired in 1901, came the fall from grace. Africa, which had seemed to be British by right, dealt the empire an unexpected and agonizing blow. A colonial war that wasn't a walkover, but a bloody slog. And Britain's imperial rivals weren't slow to scent the opportunity that this new vulnerability presented. What happened in this remote African landscape 110 years ago typified what came to be known as the Scramble for Africa, though the Scramble of Africa would be closer to the mark. Once the British had come to Africa to stamp out slavery and spread Christianity. Their motives for carving the continent up like a cake were very different. One part economics, one part grand strategy, no part altruism.
In the mid-19th century, apart from a few coastal stations, Africa was the last blank sheet in the imperial world atlas. Then, in the space of just a couple of decades, what had been 10,000 independent African kingdoms were turned into just 40 European colonies. Never in human history had there been such a drastic redrawing of the map of a continent. By 1900, Britain owned literally half of Africa.
The key to the extraordinary expansion of the British Empire through the uncharted lands of Africa was firepower, backed by financial power. This combination was personified by two titans of the age. The mining tycoon Cecil Rhodes and the banker Nathaniel Rothschild. For Rothschild, Africa was a potentially huge source of minerals, above all, gold. In 1888, he agreed to finance the development of a new gold concession Rhodes had acquired north of the Zambezi River. The land Rhodes coveted belonged to the Matabele. Rhodes had acquired a claim to it with a promise of £500 and a shaky cross from the Matabele chief, Lobengula. But when Lobengula realised he'd been hoodwinked into signing over not just mineral rights, but all his rights, he decided to take Rhodes on. The Matabele had, by African standards, a powerful and well-organised army. But Rhodes' mercenaries held the trump card. The Maxim machine gun. The Maxim fired 50 times faster than the fastest rifle. And with fantastic accuracy. ...1,500 Matabele warriors were wiped out. Just 4 of the invaders died. Lest anyone should be in any doubt as to who had masterminded the operation, the conquered territory was renamed Rhodesia.
This is the official Matabeleland campaign souvenir from the Kimberley Library, which kicks off with Mr. Rhodes's tribute to the conquerors of the Matabele savages. But the real highlight is this extraordinary hymn to the expedition's favourite weapon. It was actually a satire on the expedition, but Rhodes's men brazenly adopted it as their anthem. And it's to the tune of Onward Christian Soldiers.
Onwards chartered soldiers, on to heathen lands. Prayer books in your pockets, rifles in your hands. Take the glorious tidings where trade can be done. Spread the peaceful gospel
with the Maxim gun.
In 1901, Hiram Maxim, the American-born inventor of this unrivaled device for spreading the gospel of British power, was knighted for services to the Empire. Rothschild, Lord Rothschild, was on the board of his company too.
But carving out his own personal country was only part of Rhodes's plan. This is the map on which he drew a pencil line from Cape Town to Cairo, which he dreamt of linking by a single transcontinental railway line. From Cape Town it would run, like some huge metal spine, through Bechuanaland, from Bechuanaland through Rhodesia, from Rhodesia to Nyasaland, past the Great Lakes, then all the way up to Khartoum, and then from Khartoum up the Nile through Egypt. This was empire building as only a megalomaniac could imagine it. Ultimately, Rhodes saw the whole African continent coming under British domination.
Rhodes justified this railroad imperialism when he said, "We are the first race in the world, and the more of the world we inhabit, the better it is for the human race." That was another way of saying that what was good for Rhodes's British South Africa Company was good for the British Empire, and what was good for the British Empire was good for the world. Wars like this one against the Matabele were run by businessmen. They were private campaigns, planned in private clubs, like this one, founded by Rhodes in Kimberley.
Matabele land had been added to the British Empire, but at no cost to the taxpayer, because the campaign had been fought by mercenaries, paid for by Rhodes, or rather, by the shareholders in his British South African and De Beers companies.
In effect, colonisation had been privatised. If there was gold in Matabele land, the return would be mind-boggling. Rhodes was learning from history. British rule in India had begun with the East India Company. Now British rule in Africa would be based on his business interests.
But that was only half the story, because back in London, the British government was playing an African game of its own. While Rhodes was working his way northwards from the Cape, the politicians were working southwards from Cairo.
In 1882, a momentous decision was taken here in the Foreign Office to occupy Egypt and so secure the Suez Canal and Britain's lines of communication to her most important possession, India. In North Africa, the issue wasn't so much economic as strategic.
It was the British occupation of Egypt that really triggered the African scramble. As far as the other European powers were concerned, it was imperative to act, and act quickly, before the British gobbled up the entire continent. The British themselves were happy to share, provided they hung on to the plum properties. In other words, the biggest game of monopoly in world history was about to begin, with Africa as the board. Only now, there was a new and unpredictable player sitting at the table.
Ayyan al-Fana! Ayyan al-Fana!
In 1885, the British consul in this East African spice island received a telegram from the Foreign Office. It announced that the Chancellor of Germany, Otto von Bismarck, had staked a claim to the Sultan of Zanzibar's mainland possessions. Moreover, the British government instructed the consul to cooperate with Germany in everything. The consul was John Kirk, a disciple of the great missionary explorer David Livingstone. Kirk had spent a decade using British influence over Sultan Bargash bin Said to end the slave trade in East Africa. In return, Kirk had guaranteed the Sultan British protection. The order to cooperate with the Germans astounded him.
Here in the archives, you can follow Kirk's struggle to come to terms with the new situation. In June 1885, the Prime Minister himself wrote ordering Kirk to act with great caution and not permit any communications of a hostile tone to be addressed to German agents. Well, Kirk replied in diplomatic language that this put him in a delicate and difficult position, but we know what he really thought from a private letter he wrote to a friend. Germany means to absorb the whole of Zanzibar. Why was I not told? He wrote, and concluded, this German colonization scheme is a farce. We bid fair to lose the fairly good protection and freedom we have under the Sultan in exchange for a long period of confusion when all my work will be undone. Well, he was dead right. The Sultan's empire was about to be carved up to suit European power politics.
That August, Bismarck sent four warships into this harbour and demanded the Sultan make over his mainland territory to Germany. By the time they left a month later, the Sultan had lost his empire. In the new game of imperial monopoly, Africa was being carved up between the European states. If Germany would back the British takeover of Egypt, then the British government was only too happy to throw Germany a chunk of East Africa. What had happened was that the high moralism of the generation that had striven to rid Africa of slavery had been ditched. Zanzibar was just a petty piece of property to be traded as part of a much bigger game.
By the end of the 1890s, the scramble for Africa was drawing to a close. A continent that had been ruled by Africans for millennia was now almost entirely in European hands. There was almost nothing about this for Africans to celebrate, but for the British, now unquestionably the masters of the globe, there had never been a better excuse for a party. The lion's share, not just of Africa, but of the entire world, now belonged to the Great White Queen across the ocean.
In 1897, the year of her Diamond Jubilee, Queen Victoria reigned over the most extensive empire in world history. Loyal subjects from five continents flocked to London to pay homage to their queen. According to the St. James's Gazette, the Queen Empress held sway over one continent, 100 peninsulas, 1,000 lakes, 2,000 rivers, 10,000 islands. The British Empire now covered a quarter of the globe.
But amid all the pomp and imperial plumage, there was also a flicker of pessimism. The British elite knew too much ancient history to be entirely complacent about their position of world dominance.
Already there were those who looked forward uneasily to the decline and fall of their own empire, like the Roman Empire before it.
Great empires seldom last long. They are, by their very nature, liable to special evils, to which, in time, they succumb. The wrong choice for England will reduce her to the level of Spain.
The man who wrote those visionary words was the Cambridge historian John Seeley. But unlike the other prophets of imperial decline, Seeley thought he had an antidote. It was time to give the empire a new rationale, to turn a sprawling multiracial conglomerate into something more tightly knit and whiter, a Greater Britain. Seeley argued that because British subjects in the white colonies, Canada, South Africa, New Zealand and Australia, would soon outnumber those at home, an imperial federation could be created. This new and greater Britain would surely be a match for the emerging American and Russian superpowers.
Seeley insisted that only by knitting this Greater Britain together could the empire hope to compete with the superpowers of the future. Admittedly, he himself was no empire builder. Dogged by insomnia and a nagging wife, he was a byword in Cambridge for dull, donnish gravitas. But his ideas captured the imagination of a new generation of imperialists. The result was to be a transformation in government policy towards the empire.
Seeley's ideas soon found a champion in high places. This was the first authentically, self-consciously imperialist politician. And he was unapologetic about Greater Britain's right to govern the world. He was the colonial secretary, Joseph Chamberlain.
I believe in the British Empire, and I believe that the British race is the greatest of governing races that the world has ever seen. No change of climate or condition can alter that proud, persistent, self-asserting, and resolute stock.
Chamberlain's imperialism had, and was intended to have, immense popular appeal. It's partly a matter of targeting voters' economic self-interest. Empire meant foreign markets, and foreign markets meant jobs. But imperialism was also popular for one simple reason. It was so exciting.
There were 72 separate British military campaigns in the course of Queen Victoria's reign, more than one for every year of the so-called Pax Britannica. These small wars were grist to the mill of a new force, the press. And the Empire provided its indispensable ingredient, good copy. As Lord Northcliffe, the proprietor of the Daily Mail, put it,
"The British people relish a good hero and a good hate."
The heroes of this popular imperialism weren't themselves men of the people. They were members of an elite educated at Britain's exclusive public schools. And what made them heroic wasn't their academic attainments, but their prowess on the games field. Indeed, as the 1890s wore on, the British Empire came to resemble a vast sports complex.
If any sport summed up the new spirit of constructive imperialism and Seeley's idea of a Greater Britain, it was rugby. Rugby wasn't just the hooligans' game played by gentlemen. It was a training ground for a generation of empire builders. The poet Henry Newbolt made the parallel explicit, imagining a British army being rallied by the schoolboy cry, play up, and play the game. No one summed up the new ethos of sporting imperialism better than Robert Stevie Baden-Powell. Baden-Powell had progressed inexorably from sporting success at Charterhouse to an army career in India, Afghanistan and Africa. As he graduated from Captain of the First 11 to Colonial Commander, Baden-Powell came to see Imperial War as quite simply the ultimate team sport.
Make ready. In your own time, go on.
We are all Britons, and it is our duty, each, to play in his place and help his neighbours. Then we shall remain strong and united, and then there will be no fear of the whole building, namely our great empire, falling down because of rotten bricks in the war. Country first, self second, should be your motto.
Country first, self second. You can see exactly what that meant in practice here in the cloisters at Charterhouse, which are chock full of memorials to every conceivable imperial campaign from all the corners of the globe. Matabeleland, Afghanistan, Agra, Isandlwana, Dum Dum. Hundreds of young men who played up and played the game and paid for it with their lives. But what about the other side in this great imperial game? If the British really were the master race with a God-given right to rule the world, one thing had to be established beyond doubt. Those they fought against in Africa were their natural-born inferiors.
Distorting beyond recognition the evolutionary theories of Charles Darwin, a new generation of scientists lent their expertise to the imperial cause by ranking the human races on the basis of external physical features. Anglo-Saxons, the inhabitants of Greater Britain, were at the top. Blacks, i.e. everybody else, were at the bottom. George Coombe, a leading phrenologist, claimed to be able to identify racial characteristics from the shape of skulls.
When we regard the different quarters of the globe, we are struck with the extreme dissimilarity in the attainments of the varieties of men who inhabit them. In the skull of the Negro, the greatest deficiencies lie in conscientiousness, cautiousness, and reflection. To the Negro, remove only pain and hunger, and it is naturally a state of enjoyment.
For the purveyors of this scientific snake oil, war wasn't just a game. It was a form of natural selection. This was eugenics. And its most strident voice was the professor of eugenics at University College London, Carl Pearson.
National progress depends on racial fitness. And the supreme test of this fitness is war. When war ceases, mankind will no longer progress, for there will be nothing to check the fertility of inferior stock.
Fortunately, with an ever-expanding empire, there was no shortage of racially inferior opponents. How gratifying to think that in massacring them with their Maxim guns, the British were contributing to the progress of mankind. And that progress showed no sign of slowing. Just a year after Victoria's Jubilee,
the British embarked on what was to be the archetypal war of empire. There would never be another like it.
What happened here in 1898 was the zenith of Victorian imperialism. The last hurrah of the generation that regarded world domination as its racial right. The Battle of Omdurman was to pit the full military might of the biggest empire in world history against an army of desert tribesmen.
Once again, the British were drawn to extend their imperial reach by a combination of strategic and economic calculations. In part, the thrust into Sudan was a response to the ambitions of other powers, particularly the French, who had designs on the upper waters of the Nile. It also appealed to the city bankers with their extensive investments in neighbouring Egypt. But to the great British public, none of this mattered. For them, the subjugation of Sudan was a matter of revenge. Pure and simple.
Since the early 1880s, the Sudan had been the scene of a full-blown religious revolution. A humbly born holy man calling himself the Mahdi had mustered a vast army of dervishes. The fanatical whirling dervishes. The dervishes were ready to die for the Mahdi's brand of Islamic fundamentalism. The man dispatched to Khartoum to deal with the crisis, General Charles Gordon, was convinced he could smash up the Mahdi, single-handed. In the event, a year after his arrival, he was hacked to pieces on the steps of this palace. It would be 13 years before the British saw Gordon avenged. In 1886, army engineers began to build a railway from Egypt south across the Sahara Desert to the Sudan. The 2,000 miles of track, laid at 3 miles a day, had no economic value. This was a strategic railway, designed to reassert the supremacy of Greater Britain. The invasion of Sudan was led by General Herbert Horatio Kitchener, one of Gordon's most avid admirers. Kitchener was also a ruthless military technician. He meant to teach the dervishes an unforgettable lesson.
This map shows how the two civilizations clashed at Omdurman. On one side, the desert-dwelling Islamic fundamentalists. On the other, the well-drilled Christian soldiers of Greater Britain.
You can see how the two sides lined up. The dervishes spread out across the plain over there. Kitchener's force of 20,000, by contrast, were drawn up
in their distinctive squares, here, with their backs to the Nile.
Standing in the British lines was the young Winston Churchill, a Harrow-educated army officer who'd wangled his way into the force as a war correspondent for the Morning Post. What he saw astonished him.
They were chanting ceaselessly. La, Laha, Ilah, La, Wa, Muhammad, Rasul, Allah. There is one God, and Muhammad is the messenger of God. Instantly, the hungry and attentive Maxims opened fire on them, sweeping them all to the ground, some in death, others in terror. The whole scene flickered exactly like a cinematograph picture. And besides, I remember no sound. The yells of the enemy, the shouts of the soldiers, the firing of many shots, the clashing of swords and spear were unnoticed by the senses. The picture lasted only a moment, but the memory remains forever.
In the aftermath, Churchill was troubled by what he'd seen. The dervishes simply hadn't stood a chance against what he called that mechanical scattering of death which the polite nations of the earth have brought to such monstrous perfection. 11,000 dervishes died that day. Only 48 British soldiers.
Surveying the corpses after the battle, Kitchener laconically remarked to his men that the enemy had been given a good dusting. 100 years on, after the Gulf War against Iraq, the Americans would call this kind of thing a turkey shoot. The lesson of Omdurman seemed clear. Nobody messed with British power and got away with it. But there was another lesson that was less reassuring for the victors.
The Germans had been watching with interest. Their military attaché with Kitchener's army, Major von Tiedemann, duly noted the devastating effect of the British Maxim guns. To Tiedemann, the lesson of Omdurman was simple. If the British ever stood in the way of German ambitions, the only way to beat them was to match their firepower.
The truth of this would be demonstrated within the year, when many of the same soldiers who fought in the Sudan were dispatched to South Africa. They went expecting another Omdurman, another turkey shoot. But this time, the turkeys shot back.
By 1899, there was only one tribe in southern Africa that still defied the might of the British Empire. They had already fought the British once to retain their independence. And they had the sympathy of the Germans. They were the Boers, farmers descended from the early Dutch settlers of the Cape. The Boers saw no reason why they should share their land with the British or compromise their way of life under British rule. To Cecil Rhodes and Joseph Chamberlain, the Boers' independent-mindedness was intolerable. Not least because one of their republics, the Transvaal, was sitting on an immense seam of gold.
But there was one good reason why the Boers couldn't simply be trampled underfoot like the other African tribes. It wasn't so much that they were white, it was the fact that they were extremely well armed.
Fully expecting another war with the British, the Boers duly stocked up with the latest armaments. German-made Maxim guns, and also from Germany, caseloads of the latest Mauser rifles, accurate over 2,000 yards.
There's no question that the British cynically provoked the Boer War, presuming that the other side could be bullied into giving up their independence. Yet when war actually came, the Boers quickly exposed the shortcomings of the British army. Not only were they well armed, they were crack shots. By Christmas 1899, the architects of the war were in utter disarray.
General Sir Redvers Buller, fresh from the turkey shoot of Omdurman, had been sent to relieve 12,000 British troops besieged in Ladysmith. On the 24th of January 1900, Buller's troops were ordered to scale the rocky face of the strategically vital Spion Kop under cover of night. In the thick dawn mist, the British hacked out a perfunctory trench, confident that they'd won an easy victory. In fact, they had completely misread the lie of the land. From the surrounding hills, they were fatally exposed to Boer artillery and rifle fire. As the mist cleared, the slaughter began.
A fierce and furious shellfire was opened forthwith on the summit. The shells were falling at the rate of 7 or 8 a minute, and the shrapnel lashed the British troops.
Once again, the witness was ace Imperial war correspondent Winston Churchill.
Dead and injured, smashed and broken by the shells, littered the summit until it was a bloody, reeking shambles. Corpses lay here and there. Many of the wounds were of a horrible nature. At least 1,000 officers and men, or half the force exposed to the fire, were killed or wounded in this cramped space.
This time, it was the British who were the turkeys. And their humiliation was watched with interest by the army's ubiquitous shadow, the German military attaché. It made perfect sense to the Germans, who'd manufactured the Boers' arsenal. But to the readers of the Daily Mail, it was scarcely credible. Greater Britain was being beaten hollow by 30,000 Dutch farmers.
What the Vietnam War was to the United States, the Boer War very nearly was to the British Empire. Not just in terms of lives lost, 45,000 men killed in all, but also in terms of sheer cost. £250 million was serious money in those days. The challenge to the jingoists of the popular press was how to make something that looked so like a defeat feel like another imperial victory.
This is Mafeking, rather dreary, sun-baked town on the edge of the Kalahari. You can almost smell the desert. It's not much to look at, but it was even less to look at 100 years ago when it was just a railway line and 6 blocks of houses. We didn't really think it was worth fighting over.
Yet when the small garrison of British troops stationed here found themselves surrounded by the Boers, the British press barons found the front page story they'd been praying for. Mafeking would be the venue for one of the last great imperial war games.
This is all that's left of the cricket pavilion at Mafeking. And in many ways, it's an appropriate setting, because the siege came to be seen as a kind of imperial cricket match, a sort of 7-month test between England and the Transvaal. Desperate for a victory, the public back at home hung onto every report from Mafeking. And as luck would have it, the England 11 fielded the perfect captain.
The man who led the defence of Mafeking was none other than that old Charterhouse man and former games captain, Stevie Baden-Powell. After 5 months under siege, he penned a letter to the Boer commander.
Just now, we are having our innings, and have so far scored 200 days not out against the bowlings of Cronje, Snyman and Botha. And we are having a very enjoyable game.
Here, playing up and playing the game, was the quintessential imperial hero that the British press so desperately needed. The reports these newspaper correspondents smuggled out of Mafeking kept readers in a state of agonized suspense. Would reinforcements arrive before the food ran out? It was a classic Daily Mail cliffhanger. At long last, Mafeking was relieved. And what a relief it was. Baden-Powell was feted as the latest Boys' Own Paper pin-up.
The British public had got their symbolic victory, but it was no test match triumph. True, Baden-Powell had managed to hold down more than 7,000 Boer troops in the opening phase of the war. But the heavy cost in human life of defending Mafeking for so long meant that this was no imperial game. And what the British would have to do finally to defeat the Boers would be anything but cricket. This war was about to turn dirty.
By the summer of 1900, the tide of the war seemed to be turning. The British Army, under the more decisive leadership of Lord Roberts, Bobs to one and all, had marched into Bloemfontein, the capital of the Boers' Orange Free State. This was where Bobs made his headquarters. And this was where his officers came to dance.
When Roberts rode into Bloemfontein, he thought he'd won the war. But despite the loss of their cities, the Boers refused to surrender. They simply switched to guerrilla tactics. In desperation, Roberts adopted a ruthless new strategy designed to hit the Boers where they were most vulnerable.
The Boers relied on the land for their supplies. The way to starve them out was to destroy their farms. Livestock was slaughtered, and 30,000 homes were razed to the ground. And the women and children were herded into camps. Concentration camps, to be precise. Nearly 28,000 Boers died in the British camps, more than as a result of direct military action. The majority of the victims were children.
After a few months of the gay gardens and strip the willow, the Bloemfontein ballroom floor began to wear rather thin. To avoid any unfortunate mishaps befalling officers' wives, the old floorboards really had to be replaced. Happily, for the accounts of the officers' mess, a use was found for the old ones. They were sold to the Boer woman to make coffins for their dead children.
In the end, the Boers, deprived of their farms and families and hemmed in by Kitchener's forces, were forced to the negotiating table. But the British had to pay a far heavier price for their ruthlessness than the dancers of Bloemfontein can have foreseen. After imperial overkill came the backlash.
Buried in this monument to the women and children who died in the British concentration camps is a middle-class English woman, Emily Hobhouse. She's a hero here because she brought home the horrors of the concentration camps to a British public that was fast becoming disillusioned with the war.
The effect of Hobhouse's revelations was explosive. Their consciences pricked, journalists now rushed to denounce imperialism. It had been one thing to mow down dusky dervishes, but no respectable newspaper reader wanted his breakfast spoilt by reports of starving Boer babies. And in Parliament, a new generation of liberal politicians seized their chance to grill the government.
A war of annexation against a proud people must be a war of extermination. And that is unfortunately what we are committing ourselves to. Burning homesteads and turning women and children out of their homes. The savagery that follows will stain the name of this country.
That was David Lloyd George, the Welsh wizard of the House of Commons and the darling of the Liberal Party's radical wing. The horrors of the South African concentration camps presented him with a golden opportunity. Conservative imperialism wasn't just immoral. According to Lloyd George, it was also a rip-off, paid for by the massive British voters, but benefiting only a tiny elite of fat cats, the likes of Rhodes and Rothschild.
This liberal backlash struck a resounding chord with a public raised never to doubt the Empire's moral superiority. The upshot in 1906 was one of the biggest election landslides in British history. Yet for the voters who had turned against rampant imperialism, there was to be no liberal peace dividend. For another and more serious threat to the security of the Empire was now unmistakably hoving into view across the North Sea. This threat didn't come from troublesome subjects within the Empire. By a singular irony, it came from the one people whom both Cecil Rhodes and Joseph Chamberlain had regarded as the equals of the English-speaking race. The Germans. Britain's imperial shadow had watched closely as the British overreached themselves in Africa. Meanwhile, her economy had been overtaking Britain's, and now her army, with its Maxim guns, dwarfed Britain's. But it wasn't over worthless African colonies like Zanzibar that the Germans would mount their bid for empire. And what had the British learnt from the debacle in South Africa? To modernise their army? To introduce conscription? To prepare themselves for a bigger challenge? They'd done none of these things.
Imperial hubris, the arrogance of absolute power, had been and gone. Rhodes was dead, Chamberlain dying. Baden-Powell reduced to founding the Boy Scouts, a risible surrogate for a modern land army. The scramble for Africa, those halcyon days of Maxims against the Matabele, was but a distant memory. It was the scramble for Europe, now fast approaching, that would determine the fate of the British Empire.